Buon pomeriggio a tutti e buona giornata ad Alessandra. Continuo in inglese. Alessandro Vespignani is a professor at the Northeastern University. He is actually, I always forgot, the Sternberg Family Distinguished University Professor. And he's also director of the Network Science Institute. And has been working for many years on realistic and data-driven computational modeling of biological, social, and technological systems. He comes from a PhD in physics at the University in Rome, but then he moved after a few some postdoc to Indiana University and then to Northeastern University. I think he's one of the main experts in the world, in the field of epidemic modeling. And so he's been working closely with CDC and WHO. So I think it's really a great opportunity to have him at the seminar today. And so please, Alessandro, you can start.
So thank you very much for the invitation. First of all, I'm truly happy to have this possibility to engage with you and all the members and attending people attending this talk. I will now share my screen so that I can go into presentation mode. And please, if you can confirm you see my screen. Perfect. Thank you. So as Andrea was mentioning, I will try to give you a broad perspective of network epidemiology, computational epidemiology during COVID-19, what has been the kind of response that we have done. And my talk, I really want to immediately be, in a sense, humble and communicate to everybody that what I will show is the work of really a large number of people since COVID-19 started in 2 years ago. At this point, we generated a team that actually goes well beyond my research team and the university, but involves a lot of research centers and collaboration across the world, including Italy, including people in Trento through the FBK Foundation, but London, China, and even private companies that have been essential for us to access some of the data that we use during these past times. To tell you a little bit about my team is we did start working with a strong focus on the spreading of emerging I'm sorry, on emerging infectious diseases at this point almost 20 years ago, and we developed some computational tools for the analysis of large-scale spreading of infectious diseases. We also worked on way to integrate in real time data coming from different proxy and novel digital data streams, and we have been part of the CDC modeling network teams, collaborated with the NIH, the WHO, and naturally when COVID-19 started in January 2020, we have been collaborating with them on many aspects that goes from modeling for parameter estimations down to the level of forecast and projections. So where does it start? Why computational epidemiology? Well, the first thing is data. There has been a lot of of mathematical epidemiology, and we know that mathematical epidemiology has a long history and tradition that dates back hundreds of years in a sense. But translating those models in something that becomes more actionable, as we say, we needed data. And in the last 20 years, there have been a revolution in that area. So first of all, the genome sequencing and the analysis that we can do for pathogens, the construction of phylogenetic trees, they provide us at this point, almost in real time, as we are seeing nowadays with Omicron, an understanding of what happens to viral evolution, to the spreading across geographical areas of pathogens and so on and so forth. Mobility, human mobility is a key element of our understanding of epidemic, and now we access not just large-scale databases like, for instance, the one concerning long-range distance and international aviation and transportation, but also the very microscopic level of our whereabouts through mobile devices, traces, and other way to locate individuals. The same is for population data. We have really unprecedented level of capillary details about the population structure, and all the social demographic data that characterize populations in a way that is really unprecedented. So when we have all those data, we can really think of different way of approaching infectious disease modeling, and you know, this is part of what has been defined the big data narrative in the past years. Pretty sure that you know that even we went down a road where at a certain point the editor of Wired magazine wrote a very influential, it was 2008 or 2009, I don't remember exactly, a very influential editorial in which whose title was The End of Theory. And so the guy was saying, you know, at this point we can collect so much data from all the possible different sources that we just have to put those data into some kind of machine learning, artificial intelligence algorithm, and we will get responses. We will get understanding of the future without understanding perhaps, but we don't care. And he was closing that editorial by saying, it's time that science learns from Google. That was quite a strong statement that obviously, as you can imagine, was not received enthusiastically by the scientific community, but it was based on some evidence and some actually important advances in the use of novel digital data streams, for instance, for public health. And then, you know, the classic example is Google Flu Trend, that is a very brilliant idea by people at Google that say, well, you know, the CDC generally spends a lot of time to collect data from all possible doctors, hospitals, etc., to get a picture of what is the flu season in the United States. This is obviously delayed by a couple of weeks for several reasons. And what you have is that you have always a picture of what is the situation that is in the past. Well, they said, well, we have millions of people searching on Google every moment. We just have to sift through those searches and look for keywords and sentences that are related to flu. Then we plug all those data into some level of machine learning that use the ground truth from previous year of the CDC. And then we can have actually now casting, and with a bit of help from machine learning, also forecasting for what is the seasonal flu in the US. This was initially working wonderfully. Unfortunately, it started to have hiccups here and there, and then at a certain point, it was really not working well for several reasons. And there are a potential number of pitfalls for those approaches, as you can understand. And the first one is a lack of micro-level understanding. So we, you know, in many cases, you can have a forecast or understanding of what will be the prevalence of the flu this week or the next week. But why? You know, you want to have instead the causal inference, you want to have microscopic processes, you want to understand if it's because there is a lot of vaccine or a non-working vaccine that we have a season of a certain kind, what is the strain, and so on and so forth. The other issues is intrinsic biases and data incompleteness. Well, we use digital media in a way that is different from the real world. And also digital media are alive. Google search changed. At a certain point, they started to suggest we can type a few words and we get suggestion on what we are searching. This introduces bias. And so those algorithms are constantly changing and create additional problems that should be analyzed case by case. The other issue is that, one of the assumptions with this kind of approach is that more data generally includes, generates better modeling. And this is also not true for public health in many cases. Data from 10 years ago about the public health systems that might not be as useful to understand the public health systems of today. And for likely enough, the public health systems across the world changes very rapidly. And then there are a few other more deep theoretical reasons. I always suggest the reading of this piece on philosophy of technology by Eugenio Vulpiani that basically goes warning what is the problem of doing a prediction in high-dimensional systems because of the Poincaré recurrence theorem, and that we have to be very careful in what kind of dimensional projection we do, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So, this is all to say not that, those new approaches and technologies are not good. Actually, Google Flu Trend was a success, even if it now is discontinued, in the sense that it was the first idea in which we could use a surrogate signal and to train algorithm in public health. And that's obviously for sure very important. It also opened the path to the users of a huge number of other signals that goes from Twitter to wearable devices, digital traces, and so on and so forth. So really, actually, this data can be combined in a very smart way. And now there are algorithms that really, by using artificial intelligence and machine learning, can do nowcasting and forecasting on the short time window in a very accurate way, often better than mechanistic models, because they can understand, I will try to get to this point, a few pathologies of the signals that we analyze that cannot be explicitly introduced in mechanistic models or epidemiological models. Well, there is an issue, however, these approaches, can be very stable with the flu or seasonal flu. All situations in which you have a lot of data, it's more problematic to put that right away at work in situations like COVID-19, where initially there are no training data. Reporting is very, very volatile because of many reasons, ranging from different regime in testing, even the case definition, et cetera. A lot of heterogeneous time, like so we all know, deaths reported today are deaths that happened perhaps 1 or 2 weeks ago. Cases have another kind of delay, hospitalizations another one, and so on and so forth. Also, the proxies that in many cases are used have been completely overwhelmed by the level of intervention and mitigations effort that have been implemented for COVID-19. So no model has ever been trained or understood or contemplated a full lockdown as we see in many places in March 2020. And so, there are many, many things that should be considered. And this is why, what we always advocate is for, yes, generate actionable modeling, but we need new data. This new data might be big or small, the classic public health data sets, as well as novel digital data streams, and as well, modeling should be, how to say, take advantage of all possible approaches. Could be mechanistic, could be machine learning, however, we want interpretability. That is extremely important. We want a theoretical understanding. So I'm from time to time, I say, that article, that editorial was mentioned, the theory is dead. And then what I say is the theory is dead, the long-lived theory, because then we really need theory to understand initial condition, prediction limits, all the effects, I'm really going from a time series to something that is like we have in modern weather forecast. So, why a lot of how to say mathematics, physics, and contributes to computational epidemiology. Well, this is very simple and very likely obvious to all of you, and always, how to say, I apologize in advance for this audience if some of these slides might be, how to say, redundant as given the audience. But I think it's helpful to think of epidemic processes like large scale reaction diffusion processes. So basically what we have is that we, the individuals, are like particles that, however, do not follow a random path in their mobilities. The mobility flows that describe our whereabouts are based on, must be based on data that goes from our commuting patterns to the long international travel patterns, and many, many other things that depends on age and other characteristics of individuals. And the diffusion part, so is this movement, generally at this point, given the time scale of the disease and the fact that we move pretty quickly, it is on a network, it's not on a continuum, where we have subpopulations, different urban areas, cities, neighborhood, counties, et cetera, individuals resident in those places, and movement informed by data that let us diffuse in a non-disordered way, but according to those patterns on a large network. Then we have the reaction part that happens within each node of these large scale networks. That is where we describe the disease. And so the fact that you can be in contact with individuals, et cetera, here you see the classic stochastic chain binomial process describing a susceptible infectious recovery model that would apply within each node of the population. Well, this is a scheme that is the scheme that we have developed in the past years. And you see we define basically a synthetic world where we have different layers. The basic layer is the population. This is where we embed the socio-demographic attributes of all those little counties or subpopulations that we monitor in our modeling. There is a layer that is the what we call the is made by fast degrees of freedom. So these are movement that happens on the time scale of a few hours and generally are commuting patterns and medium or short range distance movement. And then there is the long range pattern of movement that generally is taking one day for the actual movement, but brings individual in other places for a characteristic time that goes from 1 week to 2 weeks, and so on, a scale that is generally larger than the time scale of the disease. And so you see, this is the multi-scale modeling approach, where we can also tune the geographical resolution, because we can assume a different reaction mechanism for the disease description that can go from more coarse-grained homogeneous assumptions, if you really are interested in the general larger scale evolutions, or you can introduce the age structure so that you have different matrices that represent the network of interaction, down to very specific studies on specific urban areas in which you can focus on the really multi-scale networks that describe the individual, single individuals. If we want to go a little bit more into the data construction of these, we start with the microcensus data. So basically, these are data of highly high quality and details about thousands or hundreds of thousands of households. And by working on those data, you recreate the synthetic population statistically equivalent to the population of the country, concerning a certain number of indicators that could be the age distribution, the frequency of number of household members, and so on and so forth. This is all can be all geographically localized and helps also in anonymizing data, because at this point, what you create is a population that is statistically equivalent to the real population, but doesn't have, you know, the family names embedded in it. Well, through these approaches, what you create are networks of contacts that are in the household, in the school, in the workplace, in the community. And then you can, how to say, build the different construction to generate what is an overall network of contacts. You can work at this very low level scale, or, and this is constrained by computational time, by the quantity and quality of data, you can decide for more mesoscopic descriptions, like, for instance, age, structure, population, in which you assemble those networks to define what is the probability of interaction between an individual of 10 years old with individuals of different ages, and so on and so forth. On top of this synthetic world, we have the infection transmissions. That is actually, generally now for realistic situations, are fairly complex models like the one for COVID that have to consider the latency time, the pre-symptomatic, asymptomatic, infectious individual, hospitalization, intensive care unit admissions, et cetera, et cetera. Those parameters have to be gathered from the clinical data, from epidemiological data, and or generally you can work around them through some sensitivity analysis, but this is clearly, crucially dependent on the specific disease. Well, a couple of words to say why it is important, why networks are important in this context. Well, because basically what you do in these models is to generate those synthetic population of households and how they spend time in workplace, school, etc. And then you make a bipartite projection of individuals and location and the time that they share in those locations. You can do a unipartite projection of those network that creates a network of contacts among individuals where those edges have different strength of interactions, a different force of infections, because our interactions in a workplace setting is different than the interaction in the household. But you can also do other constructions. For instance, you can use those multi-layer networks in which you really separate the educational setting, the community, the house, or the workplaces. You have a certain kind of interactions there. And then individuals are across those layers. Those interactions can even change in time because you might have, for instance, mitigation policies that enters. And so you work with those networks where time is shifting. In other cases, you might want to work with representation where the layers of the network are the age of individuals so that you have those you take care of the importance of contact across different ages. This is, for instance, is a very important aspect in COVID-19 because the disease has such a disproportionate impact across the different age brackets that actually characterizing the population in terms of age is extremely important. And so you see, these are constructions that are underlying those models depending on the scale at which you're working. Well, in the last 2 years, everybody talked about models in terms of forecast. And so I want to spend really a couple of minutes just to say that, a few minutes to say that models is really much more than forecast. And not in the sense of theoretical or academic work. Really, they provide information like situational awareness. And I will give you an example for that. When you are in lack of data, intervention planning, epidemiological explanations. If you want to understand what is the impact of a certain pre-symptomatic level of transmission, you need to use models. And then structured reasoning, all the counterfactuals that we always use and can do in models that we cannot do and carry out in reality. Here, I just put some papers from our collaborations. For instance, we did the counterfactual to estimate the effect of eviction moratoria in the US. So that's something important, or to understand, you know, the impact of of the economic status of different of lockdowns on census tract with different economic statuses, et cetera, et cetera. So this is this work, you know, the community, the modeling community has produced during the last 2 years, really hundreds of papers that have spanned those dimensions and have been very valuable in understanding and informing what could be our response to COVID. I give you a couple of examples here of before going into the forecast. So now we are 2 years into this pandemic and we tend to to forget what happened 2 years ago. And the issue is what models and algorithms were telling us about COVID-19 in January 2020, for instance, you know, and February. Well, you know, the first use of models was for situational awareness. So in China, there were a few tens of cases detected, and there was this cluster of atypical pneumonia, et cetera. But then at a certain point, we got the news that there were two introductions of SARS-CoV-2 in Thailand and one in Japan. Well, at that moment, you can start to use in a very simple way mobility data. We know the origin destination flow from all places in the world, and say, well, if we have a certain magnitude, a certain epidemic size, what is the probability that I will detect two cases in Thailand and one case in Japan? And then you can, how to say, reverse engineer this calculation and say, if I have observed two cases in Thailand and one in Japan, what is the likelihood of a certain size of the epidemic in the epicenter at the time it was one? Well, this kind of calculation, when you know all the traffic in real time, can be done. And in January, in mid-January, was giving us thousands of cases in one. By the 26th of January or something like that, we were already at tens of thousands, really tens of thousands of cases. So this is a classic situation of where model provides you situational awareness. You don't have yet an infrastructure to test people, to get real data. You know, everybody was scrambling to understand what was the situation, but models were telling, guys, you have something big here. And for sure, there is human-to-human transmission. At this point, there are not 50,000 people infected just from a single spillover. And this indeed raised a lot of red flags in those days and started all the process of working on COVID-19. When you start to get more data, you can use mechanistic modeling approaches to test things, you know, to measure counterfactual that would be hardly measurable in reality. One approach that we use was to understand what was the impact of travel restrictions on delaying and containing the epidemic. Well, you see here what happened, and that's the model really tells you very quickly what's going on. One was the major contributor for introductions of COVID across the world. But when you do a full ban on one, what happens is that there are cases across other places in China, and they start to become the contributor to the infection in other places. And then you can do the travel restriction to China, but you know, you're always a little bit late in this chase. And what you do is that at that point, actually the epidemic was already spreading in many other places with what we call cryptic transmission that was not detected. No country had really massive testing capabilities at that time. And the only testing was based on travel history to and from China. And so cases were traveling undetected. And the modeling was telling that, yes, you can do travel restriction. They will reduce the introduction of cases by a large number, even 70-80% of the cases are not entering if you do those travel restrictions or bans. But you have enough cases generally when you detect local transmission that then the things is already in a sense out of the box. So you get to buy time with travel restrictions, but then you have to use that time. Indeed, this is a little bit what was not done during end of January, February, early March in some cases. So this is what we call this, that what models can tell you about the cryptic transmission of SARS. Because at that point, the model can really tell you, well, these are the cases and how they are spreading. Actually, there were no mitigation. So in a sense, it's even a situation that is, I don't want to say that is a walk in the park, but you know, as many less problems than what is simulating things where you start to have all the possible mitigation measures introduced in the countries. And you see that in Europe and United States, there were just a handful of cases detected. The handful generally coming cases from China, while there were at certain point by February 20, thousands of transmissions in both Europe and US. You don't see those because we know this is a disease that has, you need large numbers to see the impact on the hospitals, but actually, you know, there were a lot of cryptic transmission. And this was what allowed models to say that basically in February, look, we have a global pandemic at a moment in which everybody was hopeful that China was containing, there were no cases detected in the other places. Models were telling, no guys, this is just because we are not detecting cases, but the pandemic is there and with really very, very high confidence. Indeed, if you look at cryptic transmissions, this is the posterior distribution of when is the probability of going above 10 cases per day, you see that this distribution is peaked around, you know, end of January and then goes across, depending on the connectivity of each country and state in the US, into several different streams until early March. This is a distribution that is telling you that the probability is small initially, that becomes larger and larger, and then becomes smaller and smaller because actually all the states and countries at that point have surpassed the 10 cases per day. And so the probability that you will reach that threshold is getting smaller and smaller. And so you see, basically, this is when is the mass of the timing for the starting of the local transmission. And another thing that is interesting to say is that indeed, yeah, we were all focusing on China, while actually most of the introductions were coming from other areas. And what is really striking, most of the introduction was domestic. So the introduction in the United States were from the other places in the United States, and in Europe from other places in Europe. So the Italy, United Kingdom, Germany, France started to have to generate more and more cases. And you know that generated cases that were circulating, and basically it was domestic circulation and generation of introduction of different SARS-CoV-2 infections. Then you can start to use the model to look at different mitigation measures. At that point, each state, each country becomes a story by itself. It depends how the healthcare system reacted, what kind of mitigation were put in place, and so on and so forth. And so at that point, you really need to zoom in into the specific of each country. And this is an analysis that we did across Europe and United States for the first wave. And you see that the attack rate of the first wave was extremely different. This is on a logarithmic scale in Europe and goes from a few point percentage to almost larger than 10% for some countries. And the IFR as well is changing, is depending on each country. And these are all estimated by the modeling approach. Below you see a comparison with actual serological data. This is things that is now we cannot do. There are multiple waves, different strains, et cetera. So is the modeling is getting more and more complex. Look, when we go into the different countries, how things are different. Because you see that many countries had very little epidemics. They were very reactive. Others received cases later. And so they had the first wave that is very little, then they get into their seasonal good time and then get the epidemic starting to raise in July, that is winter, for instance, in Argentina. And so there are many, many differences that at this point have to be considered really to understand what is the shape of the epidemic. And unfortunately, this is something that was very difficult to communicate in the media, where people were looking at the course of the epidemic by looking at the world number of cases or a specific region without understanding, you know, yes, now it's summer, we had very heavy lockdown in Europe, it's going better. Are you looking at Argentina, Mexico, other places where things instead are going in a very different direction? And this has always been a complex point in communication, that an epidemic, you cannot just understand through looking into your backyard, but you have really to look at it globally. So when we go to scenarios and forecast, these approaches, modeling is obviously the backbone of those. But we need, and here there is another point in communication that has been always miscommunicated and misunderstood in public media, etc. So forecast can have a time horizon that is no more than 2 to 4 weeks, and the 4 weeks are already, I would say, arguable. When you look at something that is on a longer time scale, then you are starting to do projection, and projections are scenarios. It's completely different. Forecast works on informed data at the moment and with a knowledge more or less of what could be behavioral changes, policies, et cetera, in the next 2 to 3 weeks. Scenarios instead works on the specific assumptions. It will be done this in 2 months. People will react this way in 2 months. This is obviously not, these are not meant to be capturing the reality. They provide an envelope of possible futures where your reality will be somehow, and try and allow you to understand and guide your response by looking at the effect of different policies, but they cannot be misunderstood as forecast. What is the problem of forecast and uncertainty in all those, in both scenarios and modeling, is that actually whatever you do, you will use modeling assumptions. Each model has certain modeling assumptions, the scale, the mechanism, the mechanistic framing of the disease, etc. Then there are initial conditions and parameter uncertainties. So you always have a kind of prior on those parameters, but you have uncertainty. Well, what you have to do is that you have to run your model sampling from those priors, and then on top of this, you have also the stochastic evolution of the model that is always there. And so you generate millions of those trajectory, and then you try to constrain trajectory against the evidence through calibration methods. Our approach, for instance, is to use approximate Bayesian computation, but there are infinite technical approaches that you can do, trying to squeeze, in a sense, to take out the trajectory that really you see are not compatible with the evidence. But anyway, at the end, you will generate a cone of uncertainty of all the trajectories that are compatible with your evidence and the noise on the evidence that you have, the uncertainty on the evidence itself. And so you have to aggregate that and generate probability. And this is another point that is always poorly miscommunicated. Models for forecast and projection have always to communicate a range of uncertainty, an envelope. The point prediction, the median value, is in many cases just not meaningful in a way. And this is almost impossible in the public debate. Scenario analysis. Well, here again, scenario analysis are not forecasts. I want to emphasize this point. But also the other things is that what we do is to generate portfolio of scenarios. And this portfolio always goes from the worst case scenario, that is generally what we call the unmitigated scenario. The epidemic is left evolve unchecked. And then we add in a layer way interventions and possible mitigation measures. Why we do the worst case scenario? The worst case scenario is a kind of benchmark, is where you evaluate the effectiveness and efficacy of different intervention. How much you improve with respect to that scenario. The worst case scenario is the scenario that by definition will not be happening in the real world, because it's the scenario that we will do something, unless is a, even the worst case scenario is a mild scenario. This is, nobody remembers in many cases the 2009 H1N1 pandemic, flu pandemic. Well, in those cases, nobody did lockdowns or anything else, because actually even the worst case scenarios were manageable in a way, no? So the worst case scenario is, first of all, the kind of general risk assessment, saying, okay, things are going to be bad, we need to do something. It will not happen. Well, this has been the nightmare of communication, because as you know, everybody instead jumps always on that worst case scenario that is discussed in every task force or group, working group room, as okay, this is just to see what would be, then we will do other things. It's not the future, but it's very, very, very difficult. Well, forecast, I'm really I think we are at 40 minutes, so I will try to close in a few minutes, really 2 to 5 minutes. You know, forecast is a kind of tour de force computationally, because forecasts have to be constantly redone. There are teams that redo forecasts every two days a week, weekly for sure. And that means that you have create pipeline that ingest data, consider data in real time, rerun large scale simulations, et cetera, et cetera. So on a weekly basis. And that is one of the issue in terms of generating infrastructure and generating data pipelines that have to be reliable, that must not contain a huge uncertainty, and so on and so forth. And so the forecasts are plagued not only by uncertainties in modeling, but also by uncertainties in the ground truth that we use to project, to define the forecast. And one of the things, for instance, is how we get real-time human mobility and proximity indicators. This is something that we worked a lot together with a data provider, Cubic. This is what we did for the United States at the level of census tract, where we were really looking at the differences in mobility and contacts duration this is the first, basically the first wave of the pandemic. So that you can use those data in real time to inform the modeling approaches. Well, the things is that at the end, you use a huge amount of in-sample data to get those 4 weeks in advance projections that actually, even at the 4 weeks might have large variation because, perhaps you have a governor that instate reinstate some mandates or whatever. So you see, this is a very difficult exercise. Another thing is that we need to keep in mind that models are not oracles. Models are just models. And all models, as we always say, is a bit wrong. Models don't provide always an optimal performance in all situations or stage of an epidemic. For every model, small differences, the assumptions, the way that you approach a certain methodology, the way you consider priors, parameters, et cetera. And so what you generate that every model generally will have different results. And this is something else that has not been easy to communicate. Now, we should really go with the weather forecast. This is what is communicated by National Center of Weather. Now, when you have a hurricane, you have this nice cone of uncertainty, you have a certain median trajectory, et cetera, et cetera. Well, what is underlying that is this. These are different models. And those models, as you see, in some cases, are also crazy trajectory with respect to what you would expect. And those models are not always, so the models that performs well are not always the same. So this is why in weather forecast, there is a long history of doing ensemble modeling. So to use a large number of models and ensemble them according to their performance, and there is another area of science in order to generate those ensemble projections. This is what we did try to do with the Center for Disease Control in the United States. So to work really with both four scenarios and forecast by using a multi-model approach, where there are at least 10s or even more for forecast, we use really a couple of dozens models to generate ensemble prediction that provide a kind of envelope that is the consensus from all those modeling approaches. This is, for instance, is what we did for the alpha wave in April, September in the United States. And obviously it's a large effort with a lot of people involved. You need resources, you need coordination. But, you know, I think it's a little bit strange that in some places, you know, when you have weather forecasts, you don't go to one modeler and say, what do you think about the next storm? You know, or you just go to one university to ask, what is your prediction? You know, you have national centers that do that work by aggregating scientifically those models and expertise. And we need to go in that direction. This is also, we did for the weekly forecast. This is our CDC ensemble report, so that we really try not to go out and say, my model is saying that, or my model is saying that, but to have a communication that was a communication, an institutional communication that was aggregating the mathematical and computational expertise of many, many different teams. I talked a lot about about applied science, applied math, applied computational sciences. At this point, you know, let me say that these 2 years are opening so many foundational challenges. How to construct meaningful representative populations, how to integrate heterogeneous data sets in meaningful way, the definition of basic epidemiological quantities, key drivers, et cetera, in real network and structured population is different from what we know from the mathematical theory of homogeneous assumptions, equations, et cetera. So really, we are opening a huge amount of foundational questions that we will have to tackle in the future. This is crucial. The way that we model behavioral adaptation, it's a major issue that now that we have more and more data, we need to be able to tackle more. In a sense, behavioral epidemiology becomes really a frontier where we need to invest also foundationally. And then there is the point of combining artificial intelligence and mechanistic modeling approach that is really extremely important, especially for the forecasting part, when you have not just to forecast what is the epidemic trajectory, you have always also to forecast what is the stochasticity and all the problems of the ground truth signals, because, you know, an health state department might get a hiccup, there might be a problem with reporting and so on and so forth. Artificial intelligence is very good at detecting those patterns, while, you know, some state might be, for instance, providing data later than others and so on and so forth. All these artificial intelligence can figure it out, while the mechanistic models generally takes into account just the epidemiological information. And so really combining the two is combining the best of both worlds. I think I can really leave this slide that